Sports Cavalcade. A panorama of speed, color, drama, and excitement. The American Sports Cavalcade.
Houston, Texas. In the early 1980s, it was Boomtown, USA, home of the third largest man-made seaport in the world, the Lyndon B. Johnson Space Center, and of course, the first stadium with a roof over it, the Houston Astrodome. Back in the mid-1960s, when this edifice was being built, the Houston Press, in a typical Texas understatement, called it the eighth wonder of the world. Well, seeing it in person for the first time, I'm not so sure they were very far off. Hello, everyone. I'm Steve Evans. Now, you know this place best as home to the Astros and to the Oilers. Several major college football teams play here. Elvis appeared here. Who could forget Billie Jean King and Bobby Riggs in the Battle of the Sexes? Well, tonight we present from the Astrodome the Redman TNT Supernationals. Now, the roar of the crowd may have trouble penetrating the roar of the competition. And for more on that, my buddy, Brock Yates.
Well, Steve, no sticking ball games in the Astrodome today. As a matter of fact, they've torn up the famed AstroTurf and replaced it with acres of mud and dirt to accommodate some really wild equipment. How about this? This is a modified mud racer. At one end of the arena, we're going to have an 80-foot course.
From Grove, California, and enclose whatever offering you can, for we need it.
Out here, and the tread helps push no problem through the water. What really propels it at speeds over 12 knots is that the prop of a 54-foot Hatteras motor yacht connected to the powered takeoff shaft. Now on hot summer days, John likes to load the old girl up with about 8 of his closest buddies and cruise the waterfront bars on Florida's intercoastal. Well, after seeing no problem go by, there's probably a lot of drinkers in those bars figured they had one.
All right, that's John Moore over there on the far side of your screen up against Dennis Anderson in the Grave Digger. Now, they're going to run kind of a unique course, you might say, Steve.
Oh, boy, I'll say. In first-round competition, we took a look at the course thanks to the famous Bigfoot truck in the near lane in Clydesdale way over there on the other side of that jump. Now, they'll be flagged off side by side, down, and then they crunch a bunch of junkyard cars. Bigfoot, as you can see, this was earlier, got a huge lead. Then they crunch some more cars. Now, let's see where they go. They've got to spin them around and come over a big mound of dirt here, down kind of a short chute, then there's yet another mound of dirt, in fact, a pretty good sized jump, and then a super jump, and the first truck to the finish line wins. It's a process of eliminations. They started with 16 trucks, we're down to 8. So this is quarterfinal competition. Grave Digger in the near lane, the no problem Fort Bronco in the far lane, and it's a pretty good race, Brock.
It sure is. That is Dennis Anderson in the Grave Digger. Now he's got to turn that thing around. Some of these trucks have steering on all four wheels. Dennis doesn't. He's got to back it up, crank her around and get restarted and head back down those jumps. On the other side, John Moore, oh, he gets going quite a bit quicker. Notice his rear steering, but it's something's wonky with John. He's the rudder's broken on that thing, I think.
I think he oversteered it a bit. Now, looking out that window, you saw the driver of Grave Digger. Now, everybody's trying to get squared away, and even though he doesn't have the power of the Grave Digger, no problem. Seemed to have had better handling. It's kind of catwalking over that last jump. And advancing to the semifinals will be John Moore in no problem.
All right, poor old Dennis Anderson. The Grave Digger dug its own grave there. He is parked for the night. All right, let's go back down to the other end. This is Jim McCasland and Chance's Ace. Now, this is yet another one of the four-wheel drive modified mud buggies. Remember now, the time to beat, 2.22 seconds on this 80-foot course. So McCasland ready. He's going to drop the hammer in just another second and try to make it through. Here he comes. All four wheels boiling through that mud. Let's see now, what is the time? 2.24 seconds. That's only 2/100ths of a second slower than Johnny Preston's quick time. So McCasland into second spot in the modified mud racers. And now let's go to Steve Evans with John Moore, the winner of the Monster Truck quarterfinal.
Well, Jack, it looks like no problem has no problems tonight.
We're getting there. We're hanging in there with them. We're getting up to the big boys now. This is getting real tough now.
You know, it doesn't look like you're doing it with horsepower or speed, but with some pretty good driving.
Well, it's the turning ability. Short wheelbase is definitely showing his stuff tonight.
Okay. Yeah. Good job. See you in the semi.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Well, John can always take no problem fishing if he doesn't work out here. Now, let's go back to the pulling tractors. 9,200-pound class, one of the very best. Tim Engler builds his own machine. Mitch and Impossible, an extraordinarily sophisticated machine. Earlier, Steve had a look at how you start one of these monsters.
Just getting five supercharged engines started in a tractor like Tim Engler's Mission Impossible, well, that's a feat in itself, and here's how it's done. A crew member attaches an electric starter to the crank hub of that front motor. It, in turn, is connected to three 12-volt batteries. Now, the front two engines are connected solid, so both of them spin from that electric starter. Prime the injectors, Tim hits the switch in the cockpit, brings them to life. Three more to go. Now, a crew member comes to this outboard engine. Now, the output shaft is spinning through the tractor. He hits this lever down, that locks up the clutch, and that will bring this engine to life. Another crew member on the opposite side does the same thing for the engine over there. Now, that's four. We got one left. Tim does that himself. Okay, he pushes on this pedal, locking up the clutch on the rear engine, and it starts. And all of this is accomplished with five separate magneto switches.
And you thought starting your Chevrolet was hard on a cold morning. This is Tim Engler going off with Mission Impossible, a beautiful tractor. Engler is one of the big names in this sport. As he heads down, remember, 210 feet, he has to beat 143 feet of Gardner Stone. He'll do that. 182.12 feet, Steve.
That's right. He did it easily, and it looked like he had the balance just perfect. Watch again. The thing to concentrate on here are the front wheels. You don't want them planted to the dirt, because then there's no weight transfer. You want them just about like that. Now, how do you steer with the wheels in the air? You've got independent brakes on the rear wheels. You do a little dance with your feet on those pedals to try to keep it straight. Tim Engler, one of the top professionals in tractor pulling, as he shows you right now. And in the 9,200-pound class, he's number one at 182.12 feet. Mission Impossible? Not for that man.
Absolutely right. All right, one more time back at the other end on the 80-foot mud bog. This is Steve Turnbauch in the Redneck Mudder. Remember now, 2.22 seconds is the quick time here.
This is a 23T bucket roadster. I'm sure it's made out of fiberglass with a kind of a drag racing style altered cage. The front of it, well, that's pure mud racer. He stays in the electronic beam, and he has got a good one going. This is Steve Turnbauch. He's finally out of the bog. A lot of steam, nothing to worry about. Oh, not as good as I thought it was. 2.38 seconds will not put him in the number one spot. Brock?
No, not quite. As we watch, a lot of bouncing here in the early part of the run. That could have slowed him up a little bit. Notice that he got a little bit sideways and up on the bank here, too. That cost him a few hundredths as well. So Turnbauch gets into third place, but Johnny Preston at the present time holds first place for 2.22 seconds. Will that stand up? We don't know. Come on back with us. We'll find out.
Head down to the port and tour the Battleship Texas. She was launched in May of 1912, and for 32 years, her job remained the same, to float the big guns of her main battery into action.
Well, Steve, while we were away, the big guns were booming here in the Astrodome as well. It was Dave Banner bringing out the old machine, Banner Brown, and trying to improve on his distance. Remember, he had a little problem with his new machine, the Banner machine. He did better, but not good enough to move into first place. Tim Engler still holds that. However, Dave holds second and fourth with his two tractors, Gardner Stone in third. And now let's go to the man who leads it.
Well, Tim, we saw you win last season at Port Recovery, and you were pessimistic about your chances after your pull. How do you feel today?
Well, as each tractor runs down a track, Steve, it looks like we're in a pretty good position. I think pulling early on the track was a good spot for us today because the track's a little too wet, and it's getting worse as each tractor goes along.
And they look like they're tough to drive on a track this sticky.
It really is. You have to run real light on the front to get going out of the hole, to get any kind of speed, to get any distance down a track. So it is quite touchy off the line.
Good job.
Thank you.
Well, Tim, here is your next challenger for the lead in the Redman TNT Supernationals in the 9,200-pound class. This is Dick Refshaug in a tractor called Misbehavin'. Misbehavin' carrying four Keith Black Hemis on board. And, of course, Dick is going to have to run at least 182.12 feet to move into the lead. As we see Dick get lined up on the sled, there are those monster motors that hopefully will propel him down this 210-foot track here in the Astrodome. Now, Dick is backing up toward the nemesis of all pullers. That is a sled, in this particular case, one called Old Ironsides. Now, how that sled behaves and how it's weighted and how Dick pulls against it is the secret.
The thing that makes truck and tractor pulling really work is a machine called a weight transfer device, a.k.a. the sled. This one, dubbed Old Ironsides, has been voted Sled of the Year for the last four seasons. Now, I'm in the operator's seat, and he's necessary because if there's any problem with the hitch, by hitting a whole bunch of air brakes and things here, he can stop the sled right in its tracks and also stop the weight transfer box from going forward. He also backs the sled to the starting line because it's self-propelled with a little V8 engine up front. Now, I mentioned that weight transfer box, and that's very important. Unloaded, the sled tips the scales at about 30,000 pounds, but stack all of those iron ingots in that box, it can weigh as much as 60,000 pounds. And via those chains, it travels at a variable rate up the rails. Depending on the class, it'll move faster and carry more weight and can stop virtually the most powerful tractor dead in his tracks.
Well, let's see how Dick does against Old Ironsides. There goes the green flag, the TNT official holding that green flag. Dick drops the hammer, feeds the power to those four Keith Black. Looks like a pretty good run right now, but now he's beginning to, all of a sudden, an instant stop. Old Ironsides just dragged him down.
You know, Brock, it might have been geared wrong because it never seemed to get the momentum. The balance looked about right. It just didn't seem to have the torque to handle the track. As I said before, the track is a bit soft. 118 feet for him, not good enough, and more mud racing. This is the final mud racer in the modified class. Ray Henson's McNasty. He needs to be 2.22 seconds.
Okay, here he goes against the clock. It's running on, mechanical problems there, or a falter anyway. This is going to be a disastrous pass for Ray Henson. Oh, yeah, over 4 seconds. That is clearly nowhere near good enough to take home the bread here.
But you can see how clean the machine was before it went in the pit. He was out of control, Brock. I don't think he was straight. He wasn't lined up quite right. These are four-wheel drives. The right rear corner tire got a grip, sprung him sideways. He had to lift, and then it bogged down, and that was it. Hope Ray Henson is watching this replay of the winning effort by Johnny Preston. Preston should open a mud racer's school because you can't do it any nicer than this. He kept the mini truck straight, and that made all the difference. No deviations in course, just plowed the mud and water out of his way, and the final result, see Preston taking home the lion's share of the purse at 2.22 seconds, followed by McCasland at 2.24. Ray Henson not in the top five.
Well, Ray, it looked like he had a pretty good pass started, and then he kind of had to let off about halfway down.
Yeah, when I let off, I lost the gas pedal.
Oh, is that what happened?
Didn't know where I found it.
Well, it's a little sloppy in there, huh?
Yeah, it does. It really does.
That's the only problem. Otherwise, you were running good, I think.
Yeah, we just got the motor back together about 1:30 this afternoon, and this first pass it's had on, it's running good.
Well, good. At least you stayed together.
With driver error.
Okay. It always happens.
Okay, good job, anyway.
Okay, thank you.
Good job and good attitude. It's monster truck time as they roll in the tunnel at the far end of the stadium. It'll be Casper in the far lane versus in the near lane Bigfoot. And in the famous Bigfoot Ford truck, we have an onboard camera. Earlier, I looked at how this machine works.
What started out in 1974 as a promotional gimmick for his off-road shop in St. Louis has turned into a growth industry for Bigfoot creator Bob Chandler. Bigfeet would be more accurate. There's 8 of these trucks around the nation to satisfy the demand. And this is a brand new one. Let's take a look. Now, the tires are absolutely huge, and they are off of an agricultural fertilizer spreader. They cost over $2,000 a piece and only last about 8 months in competition. Now, the engine is a Ford 460 iron V8 that's stroked out to a little over 500 cubic inches, has a supercharger, and produces about 800 horsepower. Now, the frame on the latest Bigfoot is out of a 2-ton truck, modified, of course, and up front, the differential is out of a 5-ton military truck. Now, there's a similar differential at the rear, but that 4x4x4 means that the rear wheels also steer, four-wheel steering, and they're steered electrically, a little toggle switch in the cockpit to handle that. Now, all of this weighs in at about 14,000 pounds, and it takes 18 shock absorbers to handle it.
Well, this is the man that drives it, Jim Kramer, the very best, really, in this business. Jim has been around for quite a while, run with Bob Chandler over the years. Dale Harris is going to challenge him right now in Casper. One of the younger drivers in this burgeoning class of competition. Monster trucks, round two here in the Astrodome. Remember now, there are 10 wrecked cars lying ahead and then 3 big mounts. They're off. That's Kramer. Good start right in front of you. Here he goes, right over his shoulder. That's Jim Kramer working the wheels.
Steve? Not only is he working the wheel box, remember, he's also electrically with another switch steering the rear wheel, which accounts for the reason he can turn like that. Uh-oh, the truck from Pearl, Mississippi, Casper, has had some engine problems, steam and smoke pouring out of it. Hardly anybody can match Jim Kramer that first few hundred feet that the Casper truck did it. They had a good one going. And just listen to the crowd, Brock. They adore that Bigfoot truck. Over the final jump, across the finish line, and headed out of the stadium to race again in the semifinals. As for Casper, well, I'm afraid it's going to need an engine overhaul.
Houston Astrodome for more Redman TNT Supernationals action. I'm Brock Gates along with Steve Evans, and right now it's 9,200 pound pulling action as we watch the tractor of Don Fenley get fired up. They call it the Texas Funny Farmer, and like everybody else, he is going to try to outpull the leader, Jim Engler, who has dominated the competition so far with a 182-foot pull. So, as Don Fenley gets fired up, let's go talk to the man who's dominating the monster trucks, Jim Kramer.
What are your impressions of the circuit you have to make here?
Well, it's a real tight turn at the far end. A short wheelbase truck definitely has an advantage. A long wheelbase truck like Bigfoot really has to work to get around that corner.
And yours is kind of a medium wheelbase truck.
No, I'm a long wheelbase truck, definitely.
Do you use the rear wheel steering aggressively in that tight turn?
In this type of turn, you have to use it. That's your main turning ability.
Now that those cars are a little flatter, are they a little easier to crush?
Oh, yes, they are. The course will be getting faster and faster progressively.
Good job.
Thank you.
By the time the night is over, those wrecks are going to look like pool tables, Steve. As we get ready with Don Fenley. Remember now, the Texas Funny Farmer's got a big chore cut out from him because Engler has really, really pulled it way. He stretched it way out, 182 feet here.
You know, the Texas Funny Farmer is a tractor quite similar to the one that holds the distance mark so far, Tim Engler's Mission Impossible. There are five big engines, except they're not Hemi. These are great big Chevrolets or possibly aluminum Rodex-style Chevrolet motors. Now, it's all shaking and vibrating. The front end is getting up a little bit too high. It stuck to the ground, and suddenly it shot up. And did it come down hard? Look at the right front wheel. A very sturdy spindle is just snapped in half. A disappointing and expensive effort for Don Fenley. Let's take one more look, Bob. He was in trouble right off the bat.
He sure was. He got the tractor cocked sideways. Remember now, this tractor weighs over 4 tons, and those little tiny wheels are going to take a giant blow as all that weight comes slamming down right there, and there goes the wheel. An unfortunate break for Don puts him out of the competition, well short of challenging for the lead.
Well, Don, I'm sure you can tell by the list to starboard here, you got a problem up front, a broken wheel.
Yeah, we sure do. Well, we'll have her fixed tomorrow. They'll be back in here.
Now, there was a lot of flame out of the headers on one engine. A problem there?
We do, Rich.
All right, well, sorry to see you broke your funny farmer.
Well, that's just part of it. We'll be back.
I'm sure he will.
Yes, sir, you can count on Don returning as we go to the other end of the Astrodome to that 80-foot mud bog and the open mud machines. Now, these are really wild little rascals, Steve.
Oh, yeah, a lot of them are supercharged and fuel-injected and all kinds of things. This is an old Pinto body on a custom-built frame. It's Jackie Hunter. He's from Texas. It's called Crazy Horse. What else would you call a Pinto that's been turned into a mud racer? Let's see how much quicker these can go than the modified mud racers we saw earlier. Oh, boy. You talk about some steam and taking a rough ride. He got a little crossed up in the fence, but still is 0.2 seconds quicker than the first class. 2.09 seconds to cover 80 feet in the mud. We won't know how competitive that is until we see some more cars in the class. Oh, boy. Firing up. One of the finest tractor pullers in the business, Bruce Hutcherson. While he's hooking up, let's go to Brock, who's with the first of the open mud racers.
Well, Jackie, you're saying a 2.09, just a scotch over 2 seconds is only fair, right?
It should have been about a 185 to 195.
Really?
Yeah.
What happened? Looked like he got a little bit up on the wall here. There's a wall.
Well, the pit's a little bit rough. Plus, I've been having a lot of trouble this year. Just not working like it should.
All right, this is Bruce Hutcherson, as we said, backing up the Macon Bacon Special, one of the most famous tractors in all the sport. The hook attached to the rear of the machine, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 motors. He can run in different configurations. He's got 5 in now. These are big Hemis, the Macon Bacon Special. Bruce, at one time, was about half farming and half pulling. Now it's about 90% pulling. The man's got some good sponsors and can make a good living at it. Let's see if he can make some money here in the Astrodome today. He is still pulling, but he's starting to slow. Here comes the weight. It is going to stop him well short of the distance required to win the class. Only 167.37 feet for Bruce Hutchinson. He'll be disappointed, Brock.
He sure will. He is one of that group of major pullers that come out of the state of Ohio and Indiana. The Midwest dominates. Okay, you've seen some weird machines. You've never seen anything like this. This is David Peoples' Lone Ranger. Notice he sits way up front in a specially enclosed cockpit. A wilder machine than Jackie Hunter's, the one to beat. Now, before he runs, let's go to Steve and Bruce Hutcherson.
Bruce, you'd think six engines could get you 180 feet, but not tonight.
Not tonight. The sled's too heavy, Steve. You can't pull it.
Well, Tim Engler pulled it.
Yeah, he was number one to hook. He's got a little faster gear. It worked for him.
All right, so if you were to change this, you'd go to a little faster gear?
Yeah, I'd probably go to a little faster gear, but I got the front end in the air. It's just one of those deals.
Okay. Well, as you know, Steve, in the noise and confusion, we had a little miscount there. Actually, Bruce was running five engines on that pass. He is capable of running six. And here come people through that 80-foot mud bog. What kind of time? 2.59 seconds. Not quite enough. So the lead remains in the hands of Jackie Hunter and the Crazy Horse. Let's take one more look. It looked like a pretty decent pass. Didn't seem to be bouncing around all that much, but it just wasn't a hard enough charge to give David Peoples the lead. Okay, let's go to the monster trucks. This is Stomper 2, one of two Stompers. Stomper 1 out of competition. Earlier, Steve had a look at that machine.
Boy, you get a bird's eye view from the cab of the Stomper monster truck. You know, you might think this area would be kind of like a race car. Well, it's not. I mean, it does have a roll bar, but these guys like to go in style and in comfort. So it's got a stock dash with some added instruments and carpets and mats and the whole deal. The biggest modification is hydraulic steering. There's no way with these giant wheels and tires conventional power steering could handle it. That means you have to have a hydraulic pump to supply all the necessary fluid. Now, it's full-time four-wheel drive with three forward gears. Now, Mike Whitt, who drives this machine, says tonight on this course, he'll do the whole course in second gear. He won't shift at all. Now, we've talked about four-wheel steering. Here's how it works. In this truck, with this lever here in the center position, all four wheels steer about the same. If he moves it forward, that will favor the front wheels. If he moves it back past center, it will favor the rear wheels.
Boy, you talk about ingenious engineering. This is Gene Patterson, the driver of Stomper 2. He is out of Jefferson City, Missouri.
And his competition in the quarterfinals here will be Steve Dane in King Kong from Killeen, Texas. Now, King Kong and Steve Dane, the crew, have been kind of fiddling with the carburetor, trying to get it to run on just the right mixture. So King Kong is over in the far lane. In the near lane is Gene Patterson, and it is Patterson and Stomper with a big advantage right at the start.
Oh, yeah, he just jumped right out into the lead, but King Kong has moved up and is challenging for the lead as they make that turnaround. The secret is going to be who makes that 180-degree corner, and it is King Kong with a big lead. Now, we've seen a break before it's over. Notice that rear wheel steering on both the trucks, but it is going to be King Kong with Steve Dane at the wheel will win this round.
And it appeared, Brock, that he wanted almost strictly on driving ability, making that wonderful turn down at the other end. Hey, more mudbogging action coming up. This is Stumpy 2, Randy Moore.
Now what a wild machine, and what a contrast to the Blown Ranger. Here he goes. Bounced off the other end, 2.15 seconds. Not enough. Pretty good pass, but not quite enough to take the lead.
You better be in good shape to drive one of these things. Watch the front wheels and watch his helmet. He is getting rocked all over that machine. At one point, right here, the steering wheel almost rips his hands off the end of his arms.
Here, it just seems like a few hundredths of a second makes a big difference in a little short course like this. Yeah.
It really does. You don't have time to make any mistakes here.
Yeah, and it's also real narrow, I guess, huh?
It's a little bit narrower than we're used to running.
Thanks, Randy. And now let's go down to the 9,200-pound tractors. That is Hale Woodward getting ready to go in his big tractor. And in the meantime, Steve has rounded up Steve Dane, the driver of King Kong 3.
Well, Steve, King Kong is headed for the semifinals, but things are getting a lot tighter.
Yeah, they sure are. Competition getting tighter and tighter. And I'm getting that carburetor set down pretty good. I think I'm even going faster than last time.
You know, we're seeing some of the monster trucks in the second round actually having to back up to negotiate that tight turn.
Well, either their rear steering's not working, or they're just not used to making such a tight turn. I just used front and rear, and I had to right to the floor on that turn.
And you're doing it beautifully.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, we were going to get ready to watch Hale Woodward and his tractor Silver Bullet take a pass, but believe it or not, Old Ironsides, the sled, has run out of fuel. So while they tank her up, we're going to take a break. Stick with us. We'll be right back.
Miles from downtown Houston, you'll find the San Jacinto Battleground State Historical Park. Here was fought a most decisive battle. 900 Texans, under the leadership of General Sam Houston, met Santa Ana's Mexican Army, 1,200 strong. They defeated Santa Ana in 18 minutes. And that led directly to the independence of the state of Texas.
One of the great monuments in the Lone Star State, yet another one, the Houston Astrodome. That's where we are. I'm Brock Gates, along with Steve Evans, the Redman TNT Supernationals. And at this point, nobody, Steve, has really gotten near Tim Engler in that 182-foot pole earlier in the event.
Well, you heard Bruce Hutcherson say that he feels Engler had a big advantage and that he was the first to hook. The track has deteriorated since then. Let's see what the Silver Bullet has to say about all that. This is Hale Woodward hooking. It's a pair of Allison aircraft-style motors. Both are monster D12s mounted side-by-side.
They used to be the big favorites in the early days of pulling, Steve. Of course, now the stock block motors are starting to replace these Allison. They're getting scarcer and scarcer, what with these pullers and the hydroplane guys using them up pretty quickly. So they're kind of a rare breed, and you can be sure that Hale Woodward's going to treat them kind of kindly. He and Gardner Stone both using them. Gardner, of course, with three of them on board. Hale Woodward with just a pair. Now, over the years, though, we've seen sometimes the smaller and lighter tractors work better. And here comes Woodward. That right behind him is Old Ironside. And Ironside just said, hauled him down. Well short of Engler's mark. Let's see what the final figure here is. 135.34 feet. Not even close, unfortunately, for Hale Woodward. So the standings don't change. All right, other end of the Astrodome. Open mud. Look at this pickup. Looks like a pretty stock piece compared to some of the other ones, Steve.
Yeah, but listen to the motor. Sounds like it's got a supercharger on it to me. In fact, I'll guarantee it. No doubt on alcohol fuel. And there's some pretty quick times to beat here. 2.09 seconds.
Right, Steve. And yet, everybody says that there is an under 2 second run awaiting somebody who really gets it right down this 80-foot course. Right now, it's up to James Hoot in the row binder. We'll see what he can do. Remember now, if he can get under 2 seconds, he's almost a sure winner. Green flag drops. Here he comes. Here comes Hoot. He's all over the course, and he's slowing down at the end. Oh, big problems here. Just seemed to be a question of horsepower. James Hoot, 3.34 seconds. Not even close for Jim. I would imagine had some horsepower problems. And now let's go down to the other end with Hale Woodward.
Hale, it looked like you tried to take the same course that our leader Tim Engler did, starting way to the left and going to the center.
That's right. Yeah, I thought that was about the only good place left on the track there. And on the right-hand side, it's pretty well chewed up.
Tell me a little bit about these engines. They still have the old centrifugal blower on the front.
Right. These have got the centrifugal blower, about a 9.6 to 1 ratio overdrive on the supercharge. They're pretty reliable.
Where do you find parts for them?
Just the only parts you can find are the ones that, you know, if you got a broken engine or something like that, you save all the parts out of it. And
glue them back together, huh?
Glue them back together. I got one now with a hole in the side of it. We're going to try to weld a patch back in the side of the block.
Put a window in it, as the drag racers say.
Right. Yep.
Thanks.
Okay, you bet. Thank you very much.
Top row. One of these days, we're going to see Allison's only in museums. Now, we're going to round two with a monster trucks. This is going to be Ron Dennis, Flagstaff, Arizona, in a truck called Leadfoot. Right there on the other side, a really unique vehicle. That's the Bigfoot Shuttle with Bob Chandler, the owner of the Bigfoot team, on board. That is a new Aerostar van. Ron Dennis, Leadfoot. It's an El Camino pickup. And Ron looks mighty serious. Going to have to be serious, Dave.
That's right. This is Bob Chandler from St. Louis, the creator of the Bigfoot phenomena. In the first round, Chandler defeated from Laredo, Texas, Lingo, Gonzalez, and the Texas Ranger. Let's go back and have a look at that. Now, the Bigfoot Shuttle Brock is really not a competition
racing machine. Chandler was only filling in tonight because of one of the trucks failed to show. It is an absolutely stock Ford Aerostar van on, of course, a very modified chassis. I mean, the air conditioning works, the radio, it's got all the smog stuff on it, but he was side by side with a Texas Ranger.
He was. In fact, he just kind of bounced and floated like a little rubber ball over all those obstacles and went on to win while Lingo had some problems.
Later, I talked to Chandler after this race. Chandler, not bad for a guy who was just filling in, to quote you.
That's a stock six-cylinder.
I know it is, but let's face it, it weighs a little bit less.
It's 8,000 some odd pounds. It's not as well, big vehicles here, probably about 15,000, sir.
And your driving experience had to help there, too.
I just put my foot to the floor and closed my eyes. Is that what I'm supposed to do?
That's what I would do. It's not what you're supposed to do, though. Good job, see you in round two, as amazingly as it sounds.
Hope it makes it.
Well, we're going to find out right now. There's Chandler waving to the starter, says he's ready. Ron Dennis says, let's go, and the green flag drops. There is Leadfoot kind of angling off those wrecked cars. Some smoke coming out of Leadfoot as well, so he's got some problems. Look at this. The Bigfoot shuttle just kind of flopping and bouncing along there. Chandler with his arm hanging out of the window. And look at this. Leadfoot's a hurting buckaroo, kind of falling off to the side there. A lot of smoke coming out of that. It is going to be the Bigfoot shuttle with Chandler on board going on to its second victory in a row. Kind of an upset in the making, Steve.
Well, you know, the lack of horsepower here might be an advantage because he just doesn't get too violent on this short course. We're back in the bog. This is the Tater.
You got it, with Ron Pence on board. Boy, is this a hairy-looking machine or what? A pickup truck once, way, a long time ago. Remember now, Jackie Hunter still holds first place with just a wink over 2 seconds. Everybody says there is an under 2 second run here, maybe in the making. Let's see if Ron Pence and the Tater can do it.
This looks like something you'd send up into space and it'd send back signals. I mean, this is a strange-looking, bizarre creation. And he is bogged down almost instantly, Brock. You know, I really wonder if the course is kind of going away. It's getting up. It's more like muck than it is mud. Kind of like mud soup. A 4.54 second time will be very disappointing to Ron Pence. And we'll be back with more of our three-ring circus from the Astrodome right after this. Welcome back to the Houston Astrodome. I'm Steve Evans, along with Brock Yates, and of course we're here for the Redman TNT Supernationals. We've got tractor pulling and monster trucks and mud bugging. We have got it all, and it's non-stop. And we've got machines like this. How about this 9,200-pound modified tractor of Fred Freeman? Five big block Chevrolet engines are just now coming to life. And this is a machine built by Tim Engler, who coincidentally is also the leader in the class right now at 182 feet. A very interesting gear design ties all of these five motors together, and that was originally conceived by Engler. You know, tires are critical on these machines, as they are on all race or tow vehicles. Brock Yates took a look earlier at how they're built.
Over the last few years, we've seen tractor technology grow by leaps and bounds, especially with the big pullers, multi-engine, supercharged aluminum block V8s, monster horsepower. But the tire technology has stayed basically stable. That is, until now. Over the last few years, we've seen, how can I call them, how about tractor slicks? This is a giant tractor tire, a Firestone, standard issue, basically, except Fred Freeman, one of the professionals out of Indiana, like a lot of his counterparts, has shaved a tire. Now, why would you shave the lugs that were originally about 3 inches high on his tire down to make it almost like a slick? Well, Fred and the rest of the guys reason that these big lug tires will tend to dig into the dirt and slow the tractor down, will bog it down a little bit. So now the trend is to ride on top of the dirt. You get more tire revolutions and the tire floats on top of the dirt as opposed to digging in. Gives it more traction, believe it or not, just like an asphalt slick on an asphalt racetrack.
And that kind of tire design could be ideal for this racetrack because the track is tearing up. If it had the giant lugs, it'd probably throw dirt right out of the Astrodome. Well, it's got a roof on it. You couldn't do that. Engler still leads at 182 feet. Bruce Hutchinson and Macon Bacon, the closest to him at 167 feet. Now, here is a tractor, as I said, built by Engler. It's got those slick tires, Brock. In fact, those are the very ones you looked at.
It sure does. And Fred is now going to back up against old Ironsides here and see what he can do. You know, we have not had a full pull here. That means that they the guys, the TNT guys, have really loaded this sled up just about right. They don't like it if there are a bunch of full pulls. In fact, if there are, then the next round, they're going to put a whole bunch more weight on it and work this sled completely differently. This is good competition. They like that. 182 feet, that is well over almost 30 feet short of going out the back. Here goes Freeman.
The front end came up awfully quick, Brock. Maybe too quick. It's not really holding like it should. He's lost control, headed for the outside boundary. If he crosses that, he'd be disqualified. And he's got a problem with the front motor.
Yeah, I think he hurt that front motor. So overall, Fred comes up way short. Yes, 151.54 feet, which is well short of the mark, going to keep him out of contention. Let's have another look. As Steve said, the front end came right up almost instantly as soon as he dropped the hammer, and then you can see that smoke coming out of that forward motor. That reduces the horsepower by about 1,000, so he's in trouble right off the mark. Let's see what Fred's got to say about it.
Well, the official measurement is over 150 feet, but I think the course you took, you went about 175 feet.
Yeah, that's very possible. I got a little light on the front.
When it gets up in the air like that, you really only have the brakes to steer with.
Yes, that's correct. That's how I drove down the track, was with the brakes.
Well, back to the open mud competition. Jackie Hunter holding on to that lead. But right now, it's Richard Whitfield in a mud bogger called Wildfire. And boy, this is, I'll tell you what, Steve, look, there's more weird, wacky shapes, I think, in these mud bog vehicles than any other kind of competition I've ever seen.
A lot of them with the Jeep influence, the little fiberglass cowling there to resemble an AMC Jeep. And, you know, after all, the Jeep really did start the four-wheel drive trend in this country. He is all over the place. But Whitfield gets it out of the pit. 2.31 seconds, the time to beat, as you all know by now, 2.09, not even close. Uh-oh, they're standing up again, Brock. It's time for the semifinals in Monster Truck. In the near lane will be Jim Kramer in Bigfoot. His competition, Steve Dane, King Kong 3. It's a good start for both trucks. The cars are not much of an obstacle anymore, but the dirt mounds certainly are. And the real trick is to get turned down here. Let's watch Kramer. Here comes King Kong. Oh! And I believe they touched there, but not hard enough to do any damage. Kramer didn't let it bother him one bit, and he is going to cross the finish line first, bouncing to a halt.
In fact, it's almost as if Dane gave him a little bit of a butt, kind of propelled him over that first mound. Here comes Dane, obviously disappointed. Let's take one more look. This is Kramer making that critical turn at the end of the track. Notice he's using those rear wheels to steer him around. And right over there you see King Kong arriving at the same place at the same time. A little bit of a punt right there. That is enough to kind of propel Jim Kramer to victory.
Remember I told you earlier about General Sam Houston, who defeated the Mexican army and led to Texas independence? Well, Texans over the years have appreciated that, and that is Sam Houston Park, in the shadow of gleaming office buildings, a quiet spot, a reflective pool, a lot of green grass, historical buildings. And the Astrodome, it's not quite as quiet as it is at Sam Houston Park, Brock.
Boy, it sure is. It's about as noisy as it'll ever get in a motorsports event as we watch the next man come up to the line in the 9,200-pound class. That is Rick Ilsley. Now, he has a tractor called Sassy Massey, but I don't see a whole lot of Massey Ferguson bits and pieces on that one. I see big supercharged Chevrolet engine. All five of them mounted up there as we watch him off the line, Steve.
Now, he tried to really be gentle with that throttle, and it may pay off for him. He's got some good distance going, the balance just about right, maybe a little nose heavy, but old Ironside wins again. The distance is respectable, 160 feet, but still 22 feet short of what he needed for first place. Let's watch again. The front end, I take it back. It looked like it was balanced real well. The problem is here, one tire in the rear will get more grip than another and veer him off to the left. You haven't seen any tractors go right. They all seem to go left. And that cost him a lot of distance because he had to get on the brakes to try to steer it. That slows the wheel speed, and henceforth, you lose forward momentum.
Well, Rick, it gets tougher and tougher, doesn't it?
Boy, it sure does, I guess.
any specific problems?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. It just seems like we're getting out horsepower now and then, but Boy, that thing was just like hooking onto a tree tonight, seemed like to me. But
she sure sounded stout.
Oh, yeah. Well, now I run good. You know, I don't know what, I guess we afraid of blow a bell or something at the end there, but boy, it did run good. Brian sure keeps it running good.
5 engines, you ought to be able to pull down a giant sequoia. We've only got 2 mud buggers left. This is Stephen Shin, the Shindig Express. Jackie Hunter still on top at 2.09 seconds. Randy Moore at 2.15. He'll make a little money. Richard Whitfield at 2.31. That's the top three. Now, the Shindig Express, another bizarre-looking creation.
And the bog itself, that gets even more bizarre with each run. It's now really more like an obstacle course than a mud bog as Stephen Shin lines up there. The water that used to be on the surface is now all splashed out. It's just a giant rutted mess.
I love the wing on top of the roll bar. That has got to be there strictly for decorative purposes because there's certainly no aerodynamics involved in 2.9 seconds unless you've got a rocket sled.
Well, here he goes. Remember now, everybody says, can we get under 2 seconds? Well, let's watch the Shindig Express. Good pass, Steve.
You bet. Considering the condition of that course, that was sensational. Stephen Shin at 2.50 seconds. Uh-oh. Battle stations, here comes the Bigfoot Shuttle. No one's having more fun than Bob Chandler is. This is the last half of the semifinals. If Chandler can win here, he'll face his own Bigfoot truck in the final round. Let's go to Brock with Stephen Shin.
Well, Steve, 2.5 seconds, not bad, but not quite enough.
Just lacked a little bit there. Just wouldn't get in there and go.
What was the problem specifically? It looked like a pretty good pass to us.
The main thing, got running about 11:30 today and just didn't get all the bugs out of it.
Had Steve been in the front of the line, he might have won this whole thing because, look, as rough and lumpy as this old pit has become, the suspension, the chassis, is working pretty well and keeping all 4 wheels in the mud driving forward. That accounts for a mighty good time of 2.5 seconds. Uh-oh, problems. No problem, as a matter of fact. There's the old Bronco, half boat, half car. You know, Brock, earlier I said, talking about the boat registration numbers, CF numbers. Well, I'm a California boater. In California, they're CF. In Florida, they're FL. Sorry about that.
Either way, no water in sight for John Moore right now. He faces a bigger challenge, really. That is the Bigfoot Shuttle with Bob Chandler on board. And that little rat just floats over those wrecks, and he is way out front. In the meantime, John Moore just chugging along. That weight seems to be a big handicap here, Steve.
But remember, no problem. It's a real short wheelbase track. The only thing shorter is the Bigfoot Shuttle. And Chandler used that to his advantage, and the power is such that he can just keep the pedal down.
Well, on to victory for Bob Chandler as we watch John Moore head for the pits for the last time. Let's go to Steve with Jim Kramer.
Well, what we have here is an all-Bigfoot final. Bigfoot itself with this man aboard, Jim, and the tender to Bigfoot. That's really a surprise.
The Bigfoot Shuttle is a surprise. It's got about 160 horsepower, and the least amount of horsepower anybody's got here is about 500. So we're really proud of it. It's a very smooth running little truck.
And it looked like Bob was doing a little dirt tracking out there, sliding around the course.
Yeah, he sure did, and he's tough to beat. He's going to be tough to beat, you know?
With all your horsepower?
All my horsepower. One thing about horsepower, you got to be able to utilize it. And this is a short, choppy course, and you're on and off the gas, where he can literally stay on his gas and use every bit of horsepower. I have to let off of mine. I can't use 750, but he sure as heck can use 160.
Should be fun.
Sure will.
Well, we're going to see the Bigfoots face off, but before that, we got more tractors and more mud racers coming up. Stick around at the Redman TNT Supernationals. Folks, it's the tractor puller's answer to the San Diego chicken, the TNT gorilla called Go-Go. And he's getting ready like everybody else for one more round of the 9200 class tractor pullers here in the Redman TNT Supernationals. I'm Brock Gates along with Steve Evans, and Gardner Stone with a tractor called Loud, Tough, and Lethal is getting ready to fire up. Now remember, he tried to pass with his other tractor, the General, and only went 143 feet. So he's got to do better than that to get on the leaderboard. But before that, let's talk monster trucks.
Well, we don't have to ask this man, Bob Chandler, if he's enjoying his evening at all Bigfoot final.
I'm having a ball.
Well, so is Jim Kramer, and he says that even though you've only got about 150, 60 horsepower, that you're going to be hard to beat. Is that true?
Tell you what, this is a pretty easy course for this truck. The cars are so flat, I just go wide open over them, so it's a lot of fun.
Yeah, Jim said that he really can't use all his power on this car.
No, he's too long of a track for him.
You know, they just pulled the crowd as to who they thought were going to win, and you got a pretty good representation.
I'll give him a run.
Okay, have fun.
Thank you, Steve.
Well, that's going to be a whole lot of fun as we watch Chandler climb into the Bigfoot shuttle. In the meantime, this is Gardner Stone hooking up with a tractor, as we said, called Loud, Tough, and Lethal. And earlier, 143 feet for the General. So he's got to do better than that, Steve.
Well, let's bear in mind the General had three engines, and this particular tractor only has two. So he's really going with less horsepower than he had in his previous run. But maybe he learned something as a driver in that earlier effort. Look at him just kind of pussy foot off of the mark, not trying to spin the tires and dig a big hole. But the front end is way too high. Way, way too high. In fact, he went just about the same distance as he did before.
Well, no luck tonight at all for Gardner Stone, one of the top pullers in the business, but boy, he is just having a terrible time here tonight. 140.32 feet, about a foot short of his last effort, so that's you could write that off as a disaster for Gardner.
Speaking of last efforts, this is the final mud bogger in the class. It is Roy Moore's Texas Smokey. Still on top of the standings is Jackie Hunter at 2.09 seconds. Earlier, Brock had a chance to talk to Mr. Moore, who is a Texas Highway Patrolman, about the engine of this particular machine.
You've got an alcohol-burning supercharged engine in here developing what kind of horsepower?
Oh, approximately 1,500 horsepower.
Really? Now, what I'd like to ask you about this racetrack here, or course, is that is it good to run early, or is it good to run late? I'm sure the conditions change.
As a general rule, in the unlimited class, the first vehicles have the advantage, the ones that run first. There's no ruts. Usually there's no ruts that you have to start in. The pit is unrutted. And the soupier, the better, because you run on top of the mud anyway. It's generally a smoother run if you run first.
1,500 horsepower, he could be a threat no matter what the course looks at. This is Roy Moore, the Texas Smokey, and he is, oh my, he has tied it. 2.09 seconds, that will tie the all-time mark in the class. I don't know what they do in a tie, I guess we'll be finding out here. Now the tires do not get down in the mud. As he said, the ideal way to do this is to stay on top of the mud. That's exactly what Roy Moore did. They're tied, Jackie Hunter and Roy Moore at 2.09 seconds. The first man to go and the last man to go are tied.
Roy, looks like we got a tie for first with that 2.09 with yours.
What we'll probably do, they'll average the first and second place, and the prize money will be split that way.
Well, you were running real strong, and then it looked like the buggy a little bit off course there right near the end, but it looked like she was just sailing, picking up speed all the way.
Yeah, well, the ruts, after several trucks run, you get three or four different sets of ruts, and when you start jumping ruts, it can cross you up a little bit.
Well, that's some Smokey, Roy Moore. All right, here is the last tractor in the 9,200-pound modified class. And again, you're looking at all of these bug catcher injectors. There's five engines again in the Black Fox Special of Gabe Kelp. That is becoming an increasingly popular combination, especially with guys like Tim Ingram building a tractor one year and then selling it to another competitor, where you'll see a whole bunch of them. This is a beautiful machine, all dressed out in black livery and gold leaf. The mark stays the same. You probably know it by now. 182 feet set by Tim Engler. And here he goes. He's hooked and he's rolling. He's got good wheel speed, but maybe a little nose heavy. And this tractor, one of the few that has veered off to the right. And he got out of it to keep from being disqualified. He was disqualified. There will be no measurement here. You can see that the right front tire was over the outside extremity mark. You can't do that for obvious safety reasons. So Kelm has been disqualified. Let's have another look and see if we can tell why it went to the right. You know, when he first left, he may not have had the wheels centered. They were off to the right. Now, maybe he was doing that trying to compensate after watching all the competitors go to the left. As sitting as high as the drivers do in these things, they can easily see that outside mark and get out of it usually before they're disqualified. Maybe Brock Gates has the answer. He's with Dave Kelm right now at the end of the track.
Well, Russ, one last pass, and it wasn't good enough. You, I think you went out, didn't you?
Yeah, I went out of bounds over there on the right side.
Well,
Was the track really starting to act up on you, or what was it?
Nah, it just pulled me that way, and I didn't get on the brake quick enough, I suppose.
Let's have another look at Tim Engler's championship pull. The Mission Impossible tractor, all 40 cylinders running cleanly, and the balance absolutely perfect. The front end just high enough for weight transfer, but not so high as to cause him to lose control. He won it at 182 feet, and you know what? Nobody else was even close. Look at this. Bruce Hutcherson, 167. Rick Ilsley, 160. Then 152 for Banner. Freeman at 151. Tim Engler definitely dominated the class here. Oh boy, no one's leaving, even though there's only two machines left in competition, the Bigfoot Shuttle and Bigfoot itself. The Monster Truck Final coming up.
Well, we got two vehicles left after all of it's over here at the Redman TNT Supernationals here in the Astrodome. I'm Brock Gates along with Steve Evans, and you know what? They're both called Bigfoot. That's Bigfoot, Bigfoot, and then we got the Bigfoot Shuttle. Bob Chandler on board the shuttle, and I see you right down there near him, Steve. How's he doing?
Well, I'll tell you, Brock, to the fans up at the seats, these trucks might look like little toys running around down here. But when you stand up next to one, they are pretty impressive. In fact, just a little bit frightening. I give them a real wide berth.
Yeah, they do look like they're a little out of control. All right, there is Chandler, the boss, and here is the shoulder, over-the-shoulder view from Jim Kramer's point of view as he gets ready to go in the Bigfoot.
You know, I talked to both the drivers, and there's no fix in here either way. These guys are good friends, the boss in the shuttle, the employee in Bigfoot, and they shook hands and said, let's race for it. And still, it is rough out there. That may be rougher yet. The cars are easier to go over, but that's about it.
Well, look at that little shuttle make that turn there. Here comes Kramer. Looks like he... Oh, look at that! The Bigfoot shuttle jumped right in front of Kramer, and now Kramer seems to just use that giant horsepower to blast right by. I think it's going to be the Bigfoot that wins it. Yes.
Brock, I'm standing here, and the place has gone mad, especially the kids. They just love Bigfoot, and he won it by a half a car length. I thought for a minute that the boss had it in the little shuttle with 160 horsepower. Now, look at Kramer. He's the only guy I've seen all night that drives quite like that. He hangs right out the window where he can get a view over that left front tire.
I don't think he can see anything else except tires, Steve. He's looking right down at just a bunch of tread as he bounces over those flattened wrecks. Remember, we said they weren't going to be a factor, and they're really not, as Kramer looks like he's headed for victory right now.
Well, I hope none of Bob Chandler's seven other drivers are watching, because in confidence, Chandler told me that Kramer was absolutely the best of the bunch, the finest monster truck driver on earth, and I got to agree with him. But right here, I thought we might bend some sheet metal.
Right, looked like a little figure eight encounter here as these two vehicles get turned around and get ready to head back toward the finish line. Here it looks like Kramer's got the lead, but there comes the shuttle. Just squeezes right in front of him. And I'll tell you what, a mighty vulnerable little vehicle he is right now.
I don't think Kramer had any thoughts about crushing the boss inside the shuttle. Look at this leap.
And that's where Jim Kramer just buries his foot in the throttle of that big Ford and forges right on past the bus. This is where the big horsepower of Bigfoot paid off. Here comes the finish, and by a whisker, a very popular victory. Let's talk to both drivers. Steve's with them.
Well, Brock, back into the arena come both the Bigfoot drivers, the winner, Jim Kramer. And Jim, you were right, he was tough.
I think he's very tough. I think he was actually playing with me at the other end.
You had a problem negotiating the turn. It looked like you went the wrong way.
I did. I went around the cones backwards, but it's come out pretty good. As long as it's around the cones, I figured it was legal.
You're trying a new route.
I couldn't control it. I came off the last set of cones, and I didn't know where they were. So I ended up going too far, and then I went around the other way and came back. So.
Well, I hope you guys had as much fun doing it as I did watching.
I had a ball.
How about you?
Real good time, real good time.
They dominated tonight.
Well, we all had a super time here at the Redman TNT Supernationals Bigfoot.